Pete has been a fashion icon for over 20 years. It was his good looks and flamboyant style that propelled him to stardom. So I asked him to show me his incredible clothing collection.
Well, Gordon, here we are in Narnia.
Yeah, this is more than a wardrobe. Wow.
All of these clothes have led to various stages in my life, but this is not a stage wardrobe. This is the way I live. This is not me being Paris Stilton, going to look at my wardrobe. This is my wardrobe. I get nothing for free. I get discounts on things because I'm a good clothes hanger. And they're very important to me. Clothes are walking art. We look at pictures on walls in galleries. And why go to a gallery when you can stick it on yourself and walk around? And clothes can have a magical effect on people or a very detrimental effect. That's the legendary Big Brother coat, which
is perfectly... And it was arrested. It's got a criminal record.
It's got a criminal record, just like me. But, you know, it was a gift off Michael. He knew I liked furs, and he went to a vintage shop and he got me this fur, and I'm not sorry in the least. So
no.
That's all I can say
it was
about that.
Because hard, wasn't it?
I mean, come on, they're dead, and why should they just be burned? It's on a coat, and it's very respected, and I wouldn't, you know, buy a brand new one. It's a vintage thing, so I'm not guilty. It's so boring.
Pete is now happily married to Michael Simpson. But the first love of his life was Lynn. They met as teenagers and were married for over 20 years. Together they would hang out on the club scene in Liverpool, and it wasn't long before Pete got noticed.
The Sex Pistols came to town and I met them, and the promoter of the club, Roger Eagle, came to me and he said, you have a great time in my club. I said, yes, you get a band, you're never coming in. I went, what? He went, unless you sing, you're never coming in. I was like, I can't sing. He said, you better learn to because you look so great. And then all the American punk wave are coming over, Cherry Vanilla, Wayne County, oh, so many of them, the Heartbreakers, and they kind of adopted me because of my image, and next thing I got a band together with Julian Cope, and someone else did one gig, and it kind of went from there in the press, but it was the clothes were always there, and I didn't feel, the clothes were just rapping for me, and the music was just a soundtrack for me, so I never considered myself a musician. It's just a way of making people aware that I am me, and ultimately I'm the thing that's for sale. Mm-hmm. I'm the shop front, and there's so many other things inside.
So this is your shoe collection?
I've always been able to walk in heels, and I think they give you a very good stature, and they make me very aware that I'm out, and I like clothes to be kind of uncomfortable, so I know I'm wearing them. And my shoe collection is, I think men's shoes are so ugly and downtrodden, and I grew up in the principle that something's lovely, you can have it. Just because it's supposed to be for a lady doesn't mean you can have it. But this shoe collection here, the sculptural qualities of some of these actual things that Westwood did.
Oh, wow.
The platform is concealed, and they're just incredible things, and I can run, fight, and climb a drainpipe in those. I just love it, you know? These are like just, these are the condom for my skin.
Yeah.
Me from the world.
Outer skins, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, I've got a huge wig collection.
Can I ask you something? It's just something that popped into my mind and I've got to say it. Did your mother love wigs?
Absolutely.
Because I just, as you did that, I just had a picture of your mother.
Yeah, but
with
we used to have wig parties and I'd model them and pile them up together and she'd sell them. She was, and it's like I totally got it. And she'd go, look at this, I can be any colour I want. And she'd throw it in the bin, and it's like, yeah, that's so true.
Disposable hair.
Yeah, it takes 2 minutes hair to go. And people say, is that your hair? Yeah, it is. I bought it. I got every colour and every length and stuff like that, and some days I feel like I'm black-haired and some days I feel like I'm blonde-haired and other days I feel like I'm red-haired. I sleep in them as well, because it's... why shouldn't I?
Pete has always dressed flamboyantly, but refuses to be defined by how other people see him.
Some people have the perception, Pete, that you're transvestite or drag queen. What do you think of that?
Well, like, you know, really, I'm at the age where I really don't care what they think, but I know what they am, and I think everything is drag. Mm. The fact that somebody, a man, wakes up in the morning and shaves and they get the hair cut and they get rid of the grey and they put the boots on and the jeans, that's drag.
Yeah.
Your drag is to face the world. It's your uniform, and this is my uniform. But it's nothing to... I mean, in, you know, hundreds and thousands of years ago, men were the ones that wore these things, and it's like now, it's not acceptable. You're supposed to be all macho and... It's just really sad that men are so trapped and in here. It's really sad. I see men, I think, you know what, you could have such fun.
Yeah.
And it's your friends and your girlfriend and they're all cramping your style and you're going to be on your deathbed and you're going to say, if only I'd worn a wig and some high heels. Just one.
Coming up, I find out how Pete nursed his mother through terminal cancer.
I opened the drawer and there was a photograph of her. Old lady, you know, yeah, leaning out over the boat, looking onto the horizons, and I just thought, she's free now. She's gone home, so... But, I miss her.
We also visit his home village of Port Sunlight, the place that Pete grew up in and swore he'd never return to. Pete Burns is an extrovert character, yet having spent time with him, I can see that there is much more to him than we see in public. Pete grew up in an isolated village before breaking into the music business and eventually moving to London's Notting Hill. I felt that Pete was warming to me, so I asked him to take me to the house he once owned in Notting Hill, where his mother Eva died.
I like to think Mum's in there, but no, I don't think she is. I think she's in my house.
I think she can be.
I want her to be in my house. She'd love it.
I think she's in your house too.
Well, on my journey, you know, my mum, I was really famous.
This was its famous spin, yep.
After spin, I was breaking in America, and on this particular day, I booked a photo shoot for my mum for Sunday magazine. And she arrived, and I walked into my other home, 7 Holly Park Avenue, and my dad was po-faced, and I knew. He said, your mum's got lung cancer, I just knew, and I thought, fuck. And then my manager at the time phoned up and said, you're on the Madonna tour. And I said, you didn't tell me about this. He said, no, we've done the merchandise deal, the record company said to go. And I said, Chris, my mum's got lung cancer, I'm not going on a Madonna tour. And he said to me, you'll go on that Madonna tour. I went, Chris, my mum's got lung cancer, and that's it, bang. And my mum was in shock, and I was like, what am I going to do? I wet the bed, actually.
God.
And the next morning, my answer machine went off, and I heard this voice say, if you don't want your career to crawl around screaming, as your mother's going to do when she's in a hospice and be buried rotten of cancer, you'll do that tour. My mum heard it, and I thought, right, Mr. Manager, bye. Change the
absolutely
phone number.
Horrible.
And I ran, literally did run the streets. We were in the other flat for weeks, and she was sleeping on a camp bed. She never went home. How young is that? And I ran around the street for weeks with Lynn, and we walked down this street because it was cheaper than Holland Park at the time. And I saw this place, and I went, that's where she's going to be.
Pete put his career on hold for 11 months to nurse his mother through terminal lung cancer. Do you know what I see when you're talking to me and talking about your mother at this time? I see her looking fantastic, makeup on, and I actually see her almost as though you're standing behind her and she's sitting down. Almost as though there's a photograph taken. Or
I came to London, when the day she was diagnosed, she came to London, I had a photo shoot with her the next day, and everyone was crying, and it's in all the Sunday, it's on the internet, there's a photo of me like this and mum, and I'm crying, and she's looking right into the camera, and inside the magazine's face of my dad and me and Lynn, and they're crying, you can tell, and I've been crying too, and she's looking right into the camera with a diamond.
Professional.
Right into the camera.
Yeah.
Good mum.
There's some memory of that that I feel.
To do a photo shoot and you're told you've got six weeks to live, and you got terminal lung cancer. And then to turn up at a photo shoot, and she just looked great. Everyone was upset because they knew, and hushed whispers. And she was like, would you stop f***ing whispering? Yeah. You know, and to me, that's the only way.
That's commendable.
And I kept thinking, I shouldn't be like this. I shouldn't be like the way she is. And it was like, I am that way. And it was like, come on, we'll do this.
Yeah.
I had to go and do these dates, I think, in America. I didn't want to. She said, don't worry. I'll be here when you get back. It's like, okay, Mum, it's 2 weeks, and the tour of America was great, and I had a huge production. And I got to New York, the last show, and I thought, Mum's gone. And I was in the Westbury Hotel, and I got a phone call, she's gone. And I went, oh my God, no, it's okay, she's gone now, it's all right, I'll do the show. In the industry, they thought, you heartless bastard, you did a show on the day your mum died, but I wasn't going to fly back, and, you know, she was gone, and that's fine, but I did the show, and I went to Ohio for a break, and I didn't go to the funeral, because I didn't want to see it. A lot of my friends, gay friends, went to the funeral because all the gay friends they idolised my mother. Yeah. Now I came back here to clear her stuff out, and it was New Year's Eve, and I was in there, and this tremendous knocking ripped round the wall, and I was with Steve Coy, my drummer and ex-manager, and the knocking was so aggressive. Actually, the knocking started in New York on the afternoon she died, and the pictures fell off the wall. I forget all this, but it's, you know, your crystal balls that are
opening
yeah,
up
your crystal balls are opening me, and ectoplasm is about to spray. And the knocking started at the Westbury, and I went, that's Mum, and I went in there, and the knocking was so violent, went like a circle around the building, and I said, that's Mum, and then I opened the drawer, and there was this photograph of her, old lady, you know, leaning out over a boat, looking onto the horizons, and I just thought, she's free now, she's gone home, so, but I miss her.
After meeting Pete in London,
Events took a turn for the worse, and Pete went into a deep depression. It was 3 months before I was able to meet him again. I had a strong sense there was so much more to the story of his relationship with his mother than he was able to tell me. With this in mind, I suggest we go back to where he grew up, hoping that this would stimulate memories of his childhood.
Pete was born in Port Sunlight near Liverpool, a seemingly idyllic village specially built by Lever Brothers to house its factory staff, and where Pete's father, Francis Burns, worked. Pete agreed to meet me nearby. It was the first time in years that he'd been back there.
The funny thing for me, even coming up to this place, to Port Sunlight, and just coming through this place, even before I saw you here, I was picking up these visual images, like photographs in my mind.
What were they?
To me, it was your mum. I felt as though it was your mum, but as a very, very young woman, not as how she would have been the last time we did the reading, not somebody who came through when she had been ill and things like that. I was seeing the almost like black and white stills of the woman. Mm. That's what it was like to see all this collection of black and white stills. And I saw, funnily enough, a really, really fantastic fur coat.
But yeah, she liked her
furs. But there was something amazing about this one. It wasn't just an ordinary fur. See how women had fox heads and things? Mm. But there was heads or there was animals. And it was really, really grand, but she was very young. And the funny feeling I got was she was two people. This is what she was trying to make me aware of. It's as though she's in the other side, if you like, going through some kind of change and trying to reconcile a lot of the stuff from her past.
Yeah.
This is the feeling I get. And it's like coming through this place was almost like to her. It was like coming down from that life.
It's more or less from very early childhood, I was very aware how unhappy she was here.
She's got this aloofness as a younger woman
and
a brightness.
She was an aristocrat. You know, she was a German aristocrat, so she obviously was aloof. And to come somewhere like Port Sunlight to her was a living death. She'd done it to escape the war. Mm. And she'd ended up here with a son, which is my older brother. Yeah. He's 11 years older than me. And she felt imprisoned here in Port Sunlight. And my memories, I don't think I've got really one good memory of Port Sunlight. All I remember as a child is sensing her pain and her feeling that she was in a living death here.
So what was it like growing up as a little boy in that house?
It was just incredibly lonely, and I had a red Indian headdress and a wigwam. It's documented in a photograph, and I lived in the wigwam. But now, you know, in all honesty, mm-hmm. I lived in the wigwam because I didn't want to come out of the wigwam into what was
Absolutely.
Going on in my house. Yeah, I can always remember, it must have been 4 a.m, being carried down the stairs in the house, and literal bedlam. Mm-hmm. Going on while she set up lights and mirrors and stuff like that. And she would do the most amazingly flawless makeup, mm-hmm. and it would take her a couple of hours, and she'd still do all the housework. She didn't just do that, she did all the house. This is before alcoholism set in, this is very early on. But having to watch her do these things and everything, it was a learning curve, it was an experience, and it was a discipline that she, you know, she absolutely maintained. But I still think there's something a bit odd about getting your child up at 4 a.m. and making him, you know, sit there while you put on your makeup.
Totally. The sense I get at the moment is of this turnaround that she's trying to get through to you. And she's talking about somebody called Mary or Maria who's with her. I've met Mary or Maria who's in the spirit world with her. I feel this person standing beside her. There's another woman there. Not an old woman. I feel a woman, I don't know, maybe in her 50s or something like this. But I get the sense of this woman standing with her. As though the two of them are...
Her mother's name was Maria.
And she'll be in the spirit world then, obviously, but this sense is that the two women are standing together as though they're trying to sort things out in their life. Because a lot of what your mother did in her young life, I get the feeling it was on the run. It had to just be done. Just get up and do things. And it's almost like she's trying to say to you that a lot of the things that have been happening to you have just been on the run. You have to think on your feet, very much like she did, because I feel as though there's still a close connection. But I do sense that it's as if she's trying to point out to you that, you know, you're coming to a point in your life where I feel as though, don't be frightened of the next 5-6 months. And I'll tell you why. It's going to actually be a lot happier or a lot more uplifting than you know. I just get this lovely sense of, it's like a cloud you feel hanging over you, and it's as though she's saying, that cloud will not happen. that's really going, yeah, it's not going to happen, because there's something really.
So she's still very much active in my life. She hasn't moved on yet.